center of the universe and the Thrive15.com world headquarters.
Let's go!
Presenting the world's only business school without the BS, with optometrist and entrepreneur Dr. Robert Zellner and the former Small Business Administration Entrepreneur of the Year in your ear, Clay Clark. It's the Thrivetime Show. 3, 2, 1.
All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back inside the Temple of Boom, which is located inside the Thrive15.com world headquarters, which is located within Jinx America, which is located on the left coast of the Arkansas River, which now I'm broadcasting from the magical microphone, which is inside the box that rocks. And I'm telling you what, it is going to be an incredible show today. Dr. Z, every show, I'm always super excited about today's show, but today's show is probably the most excited I've ever been.
Ever?
Out of all the shows I've talked about where I've always said this is the most excited I've ever been, this really is the most exciting show that I've ever been a part of.
Are you being disingenuous? Are you, what about bobbing me?
No,
are
I'm sure, I mean, but part of, part of it is, I have
Is that corn hand shucked?
Oh, the best. Oh. No, no, listen. You have, for those of you who don't know what he's referencing, there's a scene in What About Bob where Bob is sitting there having dinner with Richard Dreyfuss, his psychologist.
He's been stalking for the break.
And his wife serves corn on the cob. And rather than being a normal adult and saying, hey, this is really good, Bob sits there for like at least 30 seconds to a minute just going,
being so disingenuous, over the top. It's so good.
And then she says, do you like it, Bob? And he goes, is this hand shucked? So all I'm saying is, but seriously, here's kind of the deal. As an entertainer, I DJed for years. And I remember one of the things that Carlton Pearson taught me, the former minister in Tulsa, was you have to set the expectations for every show to your audience as well as to yourself that this is going to be something you want to listen to. This is something you want to, it's worth their time. And so I'm telling you, if you're in the audience right now, if you're listening right now, today's show is worth your time because so many of us struggle to influence other people. We have a great idea, and we get more poor as a result of trying to give away our idea or sell our product to the planet. We believe so strongly in our product, but we just can't convince people to say yes. And the penalty you pay when you can't do it is you just keep getting more and more poor. It's not a good situation. So inside the box that rocks today, we brought on Tim Redmond, a guy who knows something about growing a business. He grew a company from two people to 450 humans. Tim, how are you?
I'm doing really good. I know a thing or two about that being pole. Mopo.
Mopo.
Mopo. Well, I tell you what, for those of you tuning in for the first time, welcome to the Thrivetime Show.
Yes.
This is a show that walks you through step by step by step.
Ooh, baby.
Ooh, baby. You bring out the DJ in me, Clay. I don't know what it is. When I'm around you, I just DJ just oozes out of my pores.
Here, let me just, as you hype up today's show, I'm going to give you some hype music, okay? Ready?
Okay, that's good.
Here we go. Okay, hype up the
you
show.
You see, I tell you what, there's political shows out there that can tell you how to think about situations in the world. There's home and garden shows that can coach you on how to plant your tulips.
Oh, yeah.
And there's also cooking shows.
Go ahead.
You can learn how to marinate the marination of the mariner.
Whoa. We're talking about mariners and marination. It got out of control there. We're taking control over the show.
But this is the number one business talk show. Here we give you step-by-step practical information on how to start and grow a business because according to Forbes, it's kind of a big deal in the business world. According to Forbes, 57% of you listening out there want to start and grow your business. And so we're here to help you. Clay Clark is arguably, and I'll argue it, the best business coach in the world. And I'm just kind of like the, you know, he's the play-by-play. I'm just kind of the color commentary. You know, I've learned a lot through the mistakes I've made. And you know what? We want you to learn through mentorship. So we're here to mentor you and to business coach you up.
As an example, Thrivers, recently I went on vacation and I brought my Harry's razor with me on vacation and I left it at the hotel room. And a mistake I made today is I bought a off-brand shaver. Just it was in a bind. I bought one at Walgreens, and my face hurts. That's a mistake. That I talked to a guy today, and he says, "Dude, why would you ever? Why would you ever switch away from Harry's? Are you? Harry's are the best razors." And I said, "Hey, I'm learning from mistakes. Calm down. That's what we're talking about here. Those kind of things. You learn from mentors or mistakes." So, my shaving mentor and my guru, Dr. Z, is on the show here today. So here we go. This is today's show. Today's show is: Are we as humans? And are they, as consumers, as easy to manipulate as animals? That is the question. Is the consumer, that would be in this case if you're the listener, are you as easy to manipulate as an animal? And am I as easy to manipulate as an animal? Because if we are, watch out. So we're going to teach you these mega moves today that will help you influence others, but they're also could be used for nefarious and negative purposes if they get in the hands of the wrong people. It's like the Force. If you give the Force to Darth Vader, you know, it gets bad.
Absolutely. I was just thinking in my mind now, we've got to go through and put a filter on there. I mean, you guys are in your car, you're just got out your Lunchables, and you're getting ready to eat lunch. For those of you listening live right now, Monday through Friday on Talk Radio 1170 here in Tulsa. And also, we're now growing into other cities around the country, so welcome, Thrivers. But most of you are sitting there thinking, I'm just trying to figure out what I'm going to have for lunch. And you know, the idea, though, that this could be something that you could use in a positive way, or that you could make sure and deflect yourself from it. You know, if Darth's coming at you,
yeah,
I mean, you want to make sure.
So here's the example. Tim, I want to kind of get your wisdom on this, okay?
Sure.
So we're going to, what we're going to do is we're going to hop in your car, and we're going to drive down to downtown Tulsa, and we're going to see four white males who have hoodie sweatshirts on.
Whoa.
It's 4 a.m., and they're gathered by your car. Okay, so you stayed the night at the Mayo Hotel. You come out to get to your car. It's dark. There's four white males.
Why are you going racial?
Work with me on this scenario. There's four white males. They've got a hoodie sweatshirts on, and they're all standing around your car. Would you be more or less likely to go to your car if that were the scenario? All by yourself, it's dark, 4 a.m. Would you be more or less likely to go to the car?
Well, I'm probably more foolish than most. I'm like, I just walk up there. Probably wouldn't be too bothered.
You would?
Red and yellow, black and white, they're all precious in his sight. So
here's the deal. Whether it was white males, black males, any male at all, I give this example to you. I would not go to my car at 4 a.m. No, no way.
You
no
would not.
I've had my, you know, cars broken into, that kind of thing. I wouldn't do it.
I understand you've got quite a punch, though, if you got backed against a wall.
I have thrown a couple haymakers. But here's the thing. Is a safety mechanism, okay? Your human brain learns things over time. You want to protect yourself. Another example would be, we've all touched a hot stove before. And after you've touched a hot stove once, you don't want to do it again.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, you're listening to the Thrivetime Show.
So we have chickens. And the chickens we have a real fire pit with real fire. And they don't walk near it because they've learned or they've observed through nature, whatever. You don't want to go near that thing, right?
They don't want to be fried chicken.
However, we have there's faux fireplaces you could put up there. And I've seen animals avoid a faux fireplace because they think it might be hot, even though it's not a real thing. So all I'm saying is these are natural things that we've learned over time. I don't want to use the word evolution because it's so divisive, but over time, the human brain, the human race, the human people, whatever, have all learned there's certain protection moves, and it allows us to make decisions easier. So another example would be you're driving to work today, and do you remember what happened on the way to work today? I mean, did you scan both the left and the right side of the road completely while driving? Who remembers? If you're listening right now, did you even remember driving to where you are right now? I mean, probably not, right?
I don't even know who I am right now.
All right. So the thing is, these are all because the data would be overwhelming if we analyzed everything. We all know people like that who do, though. They're like, oh, my gosh, did you see that squirrel? And you're going, how did you see a squirrel? How are you driving a car while seeing a squirrel? The thing is, these are all shortcuts we make that allow us to make decisions faster. But the problem is when charlatans discover these dark arts, they'll use them against you. And so we're going to go ahead and identify the seven manipulation moves that are used all the time in sales. For us or against us, whatever. So here we go into the first one. One is humans have an overpowering need to reciprocate favors. So here's kind of a funny one. And here's kind of a dark one. If you want your kid to become popular at school, invite all of the kids to a party. And I have done this. So if your kid, hypothetically, is going to Metro Christian for the first time and you want her to be a popular kid and for all the kids to know her, you just invite all the kids, even the kids you don't even know. You just go to the teacher, hey, who are all the kids? I'll invite the kids. And if your kid has been invited to a party, guess who you invite to your party, Z?
The person that invited you because you feel like you need to reciprocate.
Okay, so here we go. So let's say you're meeting with a financial consultant who's a dirty, dirty guy. He is not honest, and he's not even a real licensed person. He's a scammer. He's a pyramid scammer guy.
Oh, man. Okay.
So what he'll do is if he buys you a nice coffee
yes.
over there at Panera, he offers to buy you a salad. and he gives you some nice, let's say a $9 lunch.
Wow.
I mean,
wow.
A $6 lunch. You know, if you get to McDonald's, it's like a $4
lunch. $9 lunch, we could go to Oklahoma Joe's then. I mean, you know,
Now, let's say it's a $21 lunch.
Oh, that's, we're upgraded. Yeah, there's a difference.
You probably have to go to Regent Bank and
get an equity line?
Withdraw some money.
So let's just say this is the case. If someone buys you, why is it that when somebody buys you a $21 lunch or above at a nice place,
okay,
why is it that you all of a sudden perceive that the person who is pitching you the presentation is now somehow more credible just because they bought you an expensive lunch? I'll go with you, Z, first. Why is that typically?
Well, because, you know, money is one thing we measure, and we understand that money is something that we all, you know, work hard to get. And so when you part money with someone, that's, I mean, you feel like, you know, it's marketing, it's advertising. And so if they want to take me to a nicer place, and that's, you just take it more serious. Either that or I'm suspicious that they're spending somebody else's money. You know, like I get a lot of reps that'll take me out. It's not out of their pocket.
They're
generous. Yeah, it's out of, you know, Bosch and Lomb, or it's out of, you know, some Ray-Ban. It's out of some big company's war chest, you know, and that's nice. But the point is, if it's coming out of their pocket individually, then, yeah, you take that more seriously, of course, because you know that money's hard-earned and money's not easy to acquire.
So let's say that you are a legit nice person and you're not trying to manipulate people, but you also want to ignite this thing called the law of reciprocity that makes you want to reciprocate.
Okay.
Let's say that you're a pastor of a church, as an example. I have used this move with pastors of churches. I've helped them grow their congregations. It works. So when a new guest comes to church, one thing you'd want to do is make sure that you say on the pulpit from the stage, for all the new guests, if you're here today, there's no such thing as a free lunch except for at my church. My wife and I would love to take you out for a free lunch, get to meet you guys. We'd love to do that. We'd love to get to know you, talk to you one-on-one, invest that time meeting each other. Make sure you see me afterwards. We'll get you all signed up. Let's make it happen. And when you do that, people are more likely to stick around because they feel like they have to reciprocate.
Right. When you say the law of reciprocity, it seems like a pretty complex word. All you're talking about is what you sow is what you reap. It's the law of harvest. It's what governs everything on the planet.
So recently, there's a person I can think of. I will not mention any descriptives other than this is just a shady move, and you knew it was. This person sends me gifts that I do not want and wants to know what my thought is about the product.
Curious minds want to know who you're talking about.
And what do you think their motive is?
They're trying to sell me something that's not even a real thing.
Oh, wait a second. So they're sending you a gift that is a real thing.
Yeah.
Okay. And then they're asking you what you think about that thing as a real thing.
They keep mailing me a product that they know is not a real product, and they keep saying, I want to get your feedback on the product.
Wait, time out. Well, that's a move.
It's a move, and it makes you want to go, well, man, they've sent me probably $120 of, and by the way, it has the little price on it, and it's a move. But the thing is, you feel like, oh, my gosh, I should
Are they like testing to see if it's something they're going to produce? Because, I mean, you know, I've heard some very clever people, they put out faux products, and then what they do is they see which one gets the biggest response, and then they make that product.
I happen to know that this particular product is not a real product, and the person sending me the product knows it's not a real product, and it's all going to come down to, would you please auto ship a bunch of crap that you know that is not real? Let's sign up for my team. But the thing is, I'm just saying, it's a move, law of reciprocity. It's good or bad. Stay tuned. We're teaching more about the laws of manipulation.
I want to know what that product is.
My name is Cody Albright, and this is my wife,
Rachel Albright.
And we are from Inola, Oklahoma. We don't actually own a business yet. We're starting a business with my father-in-law, her dad, Sierra Pools and Spas.
We actually heard about it from my dad, who listens to the Thrivetime show on 1170, and he's an entrepreneur, so he recommended this conference to us. I have learned mainly just the skills to get started with the business. I kind of came in like not knowing even where to start, where to begin, just feeling a little bit overwhelmed with the whole process. And I feel like Clay really gave us the information to not only get started, but once we do get started, to get moving with the business and actually get things rolling.
Being in the beginning process, I don't know much. I didn't come into this conference. I didn't know much about sales, business, marketing, and nothing I learned in high school, and so I feel like I learned actually a tremendous amount of things, practical things I could put to use. I would describe it very welcoming, atmospheric, warm. Is that a word? I guess.
Yeah, it's very relaxed. Clay is very great speaker. He made it really fun, lots of energy. So yeah, it was a great experience.
Very homey.
It's awesome. It's a little bit eclectic, but you definitely get a sense of what they believe in and their energy here and their purpose here. You can definitely see it all over the walls and everywhere.
I would describe him very well, a very well communicator, very funny, very energetic, very passionate, very knowledgeable, and just fun to listen to.
He's very interactive. Clay always was there to answer any questions that we have. At any point we could answer any or ask any questions, and he was very willing to answer them. And even in between, he's very approachable. Talk to him about anything. I would say they're missing just the jump start to get their business to a place where it's serving them and where it's really making the profit that they want to see. It's accomplishing the goals that they have in their mind. I'd say they're missing the practical skills to make that happen. Clay does not try to upsell you on anything. He's definitely here to just help you out. He wants to give you all the skills that you need to get your business where you want it to be. So there's no pressure. It's totally relaxed.
Yes, I would say, I describe it no pressure, and I'm a people pleaser, so I would fall into those sort of things and things. But yeah, I would say it's very relaxed, very non-pushy.
It's definitely worth your time. It's definitely worth the money. Because all the things that he's going to teach you, you learn them in a very quick amount of time, but they're all very applicable if you actually put in the time to use them.
All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back into the conversation. It's the Thrive Time Show on your radio. My name is Clay Clark. I'm a former Entrepreneur of the Year and the former disc jockey of choice for the Yucatan Liquor Stand, where you used to get $1 long necks on Thirsty Thursdays. I'm telling you, many people are listening going, I want to go back to a time.
I want a dollar long neck.
I want to go back in a time in American history where the Yucatan Liquor Stand existed in what is now the parking lot of Sunshine Furniture. I want to go back to that time when that used to be a Target and that used to be a Yucatan Liquor Stand. And I know you're saying that, but the worry you have is, what if you can't go back?
What if you can?
What if you get trapped and you're separated from your family?
What? Are you be like a time machine that go back as a time machine?
Many people are worried about these things. There's about three or four people out there listening that are just worried about this.
Like,
and I'm saying, let it go.
Let it go.
Now, today we're talking about it's manipulation mastery. You're trying to learn the manipulation strategies that the human race uses as a way to kind of shortcuts to logic, okay? And it's so, you know, you might be going, are you kidding me? Is this what you're talking about? No, seriously. There are people out there that will use these moves for you and against you, and you have to learn these methods and decide for yourself whether you want to use them for your business or whether you want to avoid them and run for the hills. But you want to also understand when they're being used against you. And so we're getting into the next manipulation move, which is this.
Wait, have we done the because I think Tim touched on something that was pretty powerful on step little one.
Watch
here
it.
About
Watch it.
Reciprocating. And he was basically saying on the positive side of it, I mean, it, you know, it's like you, tongue-in-cheek, we talked about, you know, the force on Star Wars. It can be positive, it can be negative. And so it's like in the advertising, I mean, it can be unethical. I mean, I've seen dirty advertising that you're kind of going, I don't think that's right.
Mm.
And then you could see advertising, you know, I mean, it's kind of like whenever they, in and out, they're like,
those drug commercials are amazing. It's like, does your ear slightly hurt? And you're like, yeah. And it's like, it may cause retinal bleeding. It may cause your spine to deteriorate. And you're like,
it's like, they really want to advertise that? I don't know that that's what retinal bleeding.
But they say it so fast, you gotta slow it down.
Sounds reasonable.
Exactly. But Tim touched on something, Mr. Redmond did, and that is, it's really the law of reaping and sowing. And so on the positive side of it, as you go out there and you reap positive things into other people's lives, and you know, we always use the word manipulation. We use it kind of in a negative connotation. So we can use a different word in there.
Well, you're out there sowing it.
Right. You're out there sowing into the world, and now you can expect a harvest, or you can reap from that. You can reciprocate from that. And so I think there's some positive things about that too. And I mean, you did the little clever thing about if you wanted your kid to be, you know, popular in school.
I've done that move.
Yeah, but you also in business, it's the same thing. As you go out there and you reap good things and nice things and you're kind, you know what, and you do the right things in business that we're going to teach you on this show, then you can reciprocate a harvest. I tell you what, that will make your wallet grow a little bit,
it's
too.
Good, it's good and bad. You know, what I love while you're doing this, Clay, is the whole thing that these moves, good or bad, they bypassed our logic and they start messing with that emotional realm that many of us don't know how to control.
Yeah, there's a reason why when you go into like Walmart and whatnot, they've got those end caps set up with certain things on them. You know, I mean, people have done the research.
Let me give you an example of a super shady move that was done when I was in college.
I love that.
This is real. I had a guy in college who I went to college with, and I won't mention his name, but this was his move. He would tell us.
But you know who you are.
No, this is because what happens is we were on Covenant. It's a floor at Oral Roberts University. And on Friday nights, all the guys would go out. And like Sunday, it's kind of war stories about your dates and stuff. Well, this guy, he had documented his moves so well that he had moves. He referred to them as moves. He says, what I'm going to do on this date is I'm going to do the flower move and the over-the-top move. And we're like, dude, don't do the over-the-top. And his whole move was, first move, you bring a ton of flowers. You take her to a really fancy place. You promise like Olive Garden, but you take her to Polo Grill.
Oh, yeah. That's.
Then the second move, he's like, I'm going to tell her I love her. And I'm like, dude, you don't,
you
though. And he's but I'm telling you, once you get them to reciprocate, and I'm like, dude, come on.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, you're listening to The Thrivetime Show.
And then I won't get into the details. This is a family show. But move to date three, he would try for the move. So the whole idea is that he would use the L word, just throw it out there, because he knew that if he said it sincerely, she would want to reciprocate half the time. And I'm like, dude, you are
pure manipulation.
So I'm just telling you could be used good and bad the
playing
same
with her soul.
Yeah, it's I'm just
her little heart, her
horrible.
little fresh heart. Yeah, that's somebody's daughter out there.
Have you seen
mine's too clever for that move to ever work on her.
Have you seen the Wedding Crashers? You know how Will Ferrell becomes a funeral crasher?
Oh my gosh. Mom, meatloaf.
So I'm just telling you need to watch that scene on YouTube, Funeral Crasher, Wedding Crashers. You'll see it. Okay. Yeah. So here's the next move. This is one of my favorite manipulation moves. There. This is the rejection then retreat. It's a super devious tactic because it involves not only the law of reciprocation, but it also involves the law of contrast. So here's the move. You want to buy someone's house, and they have their house listed for $200.
Okay.
And you tell the guy, I love that house. This house is great.
It's the best.
And you say, is someone else looking at it? He goes, someone else says. You say, well, when do you need to sell the house? I need to sell the house by April 1st. And you go, well, I tell you what, if you can take it off the market, I am committed that I'm ready to move forward on before April 1st. I commit to you. Verbally, he says, I commit. Then it's like March 25th, 26th. You don't have an offer. You call him, and he goes, after doing some other research, you know, I know you guys need to sell it by the 1st. I could do it for $165.
Ooh, dirty move.
So now it's been off the market.
Yeah, now you leave
now
him
you
hanging.
Feel like you kind of are like, what?
You've already sold it to this guy emotionally.
Right. You've already planned on moving. You've already planned on it. Your wife's ready to go. You've cleaned the house, ready to go. And then you go, $165, I couldn't do it. And there's no way. That seems too low. No way. That's not ethical. And then he goes, all right, I could do it for $190. And he just got $10,000 off of a price you already agreed on by coming in low. But the law of contrast, you're like, well, it's not as low as $165. Yeah. And I have worked with many people in the real estate game, and one of the guys I used to work with often, he had this move, and he would do this move. He would refer to this move by name. He'd go, I'm doing the law of contrast. It's going to be awesome. And it was a move, and I'm like, you can't do that. He's a house flipper. And this was his whole move, was he would just go in, get somebody all hot and bothered. He'd go, how much do you want? They'd say $200. Seems reasonable. Seems like we could move forward at that price. $200 is what you're thinking. Seems reasonable. If you could take that off the market, I would like to evaluate it, but I'm moving forward for sure. Then he would come back in with that dirty $165 move.
Well, here's the takeaway. If you're selling your house and someone comes in and tries to do that move on you, if it's not in writing, it's not binding in real estate. So if it's not in writing, you tell them, well, okay, great. Well, as soon as I get a contract, I'll take it off the market. Or as soon as I get, you know, a written contract, then I'll take it off the market. But I'm not going to take it off the market without a written contract. So then you can't get those yahoos doing that flip on you and coming in and saying that. Because that's a dirty move, and it happens every day. And woe be it that it's not you that falls for that, because now you're like, oh, you know what? I listen to the Thrivetime show. I know that move.
I once worked at an electronics store, and we come back. I want to hear Tim's take on this, okay? I worked at an electronics store. I will not mention the name, but my job, my boss would say, he'd walk up to me and go, hey, raise it up to lower it. And I would say, what? The first time he said it, I go, what do you mean? Just raise it up and lower it. I go, what do you mean? Well, the price of the TV, let's say, this is before flat screen TVs, but the price of the TV is $500 and it's not selling. Raise it up and say regular price, $650. And then put the real price at $500. I'm like, so you want me to raise the price $150 more than it actually is and then say it's now a discount at $500? He goes, absolutely.
Beautiful, and I'm like, law of contrast.
And I'm like, how would you know? He goes, no one's going to remember what the price was. People think it's a great deal. The law of contrast. It's a move.
The law of contrast. It's a move.
These are moves. So stay tuned. Thrivetime Show. We're teaching you the laws of manipulation. I'm going to take a shower after today's episode. I feel so dirty.
Well, yeah, I may start go flipping homes. I don't know.
A little song I wrote. I'd want to sing it note for note.
I'm Augustine Icapelli, and I'm from Wichita, Kansas, and CEO of Augustino Brewing. Well, I heard about them from, I'd already been a Thriver on Thrive 15, and through that platform, I found out that there were in-person workshops and one-on-one coaching available, so I decided to check it out, and it's been fantastic. Oh, I've learned a lot about how we're going to better target our online presence for our business to attract and bring more people into the doors of our brick and mortar brewery and restaurant.
It is the Thrivetime Show on your AM radio. It is the noontime, and I'm telling you what, you could be, Z, you could be at Oklahoma Joe's right now having some baked beans. You could be doing that.
Why wouldn't I be? Oh, well, I've got to do the show. That's why. I mean, but right after the show, let's run over there.
Have you ever thought about eating barbecue on the show one time? Just like one time, work the entire show. You know, they say you shouldn't talk with your mouth full. You ever thought about just doing an entire show where that's all we do is talk with our mouth full?
Well, that we didn't do, but there was one show. I think it was the second or maybe third show we did with Joe Davidson, the owner and founder of Oklahoma Joe's.
Yeah.
Hence the name Oklahoma Joe's. And he actually, the first time he came on, I kind of shamed him into, apologizing for not bringing food. And then the next couple times he did bring food. And we, in the break, we just scarfed it down for lunch. I remember that.
You know, in some of the pilot shows, I was covering my entire body with Oklahoma Joe's food and just trying to. And they wouldn't let us air those pilots. They said, you can't put them on the podcast. You can't have any evidence that it occurred. But it was worth the effort.
Yeah, that was back in the old studio. And they got it so sticky, we had to move out of here. There were so many, ants and bugs. And
it got uncomfortable.
It got uncomfortable. It was kind of weird.
Now, we're talking today, Thrivers, about the rules of manipulation. These are, what happens is humans, we tend to use predictable shortcuts to deal with decision-making situations, because over time we realize if I touch the hot stove, I will burn my hand. Henceforth, when I see a hot stove, I will not touch my hand. So psychologists will do these crazy research on people. You know, Freud would probably go to jail if he was alive today for all the crazy things he was doing. But the idea is you could paint stove, you know, you could paint the stovetop there and make it look like it was the color of like a hot orange stovetop.
Yeah.
And people won't touch it because they're assuming that it's hot, obviously, you know. But you paint it and they assume it's hot and then they don't touch it. And then you're like, haha, see, it's not hot. So you kind of, the human brain has found ways to predict itself, protect itself in predictable ways. And so we were just talking about the rejection, then the retreat move, which is basically you ask for a crazy thing and the person says no. And then as a concession, you ask for something less crazy, but it seems like a good move.
Well, the thing about that made that so dirty is that you negotiated one price early on.
You've already given your word.
And then your verbal word. And then you've waited the time frame and you've taken away that negotiating time. And so now, you know, when it's crunch time, then you slide in with the ridiculous offer.
Yeah.
And then you adjust it to something closer to what you originally offered. And then that's so dirty.
Especially with people that sell a house maybe three times in their whole life. There's not like their experience with this emotion. So there's a whole flood of emotion.
Yeah.
Really, this manipulation moves is really all about emotional management, isn't it, Clay?
It is. And these are moves. I'm trying to help you grow your business. And so here is how you would use this for good.
Yes, thank you.
In the wedding photography realm, typically a bride wants two photographers because she wants to get a photo of her seeing the groom for the first time and of him seeing her for the first time. They want two different perspectives to the events that happen. That's why they want two photographers.
That makes sense.
Now, that being said, very few people want two photographers and two videographers. It's typically like two photographers and one videographer.
Okay, that's fair.
So what you do is you design three packages, and I've done this. The first package is so cheap. It's like one photographer and that's it. It's 4 hours of coverage. The second package, if someone books the first package, you almost feel bad because you're like, that is such a lame package. You're not going to get what you want. The second package is two photographers and includes one videographer, and it's unlimited time. So the deal is such a good deal. You're like, why would I not do that? And then the third package is out of control. And if anyone buys it, you just giggle. You're just like, oh.
Oh, yeah.
So, and I learned this from my mentor, Lori Montek. She taught me the move. So you're like, it includes three photographers, three videographers, and a photo booth. And
so we have a photographer taking pictures of the photographer taking a picture of you.
A dream within a dream. It's yes. Like the Matrix.
Yeah. Well, it's, yeah.
Inception. So what happens is, show the bride the different options and you say, now based on what we talked about today, I'd recommend the second package. That includes two photographers, one videographer. Most brides do that. Or you could look at the third, which one seems best to you? And the bride's like, well, I don't want to have a $10,000 wedding package, so I'll do the second one. You know, it seems more reasonable.
Yeah, you always go with most people go with the middle. That's the move. You do a low end. You can advertise a low end deal, and then you have the high end just to make sure that's right in the middle.
That's why our show goes so well. You're high end, I'm low end. By contrast, people choose Tim.
There's nothing dirty.
Right,
I mean, that's a lot of businesses use that. We use that too. And, you know, different packages you can for lenses. You know, you have the low end, you have the high end, and you have the one right in the middle. It's kind of like the story of Little Goldilocks.
So,
you
Tim, I want to get your.
The porridge is too hot. The porridge is too cold.
This porridge is just right.
Just right.
Tim, I want to pick your brain on this. So, here we go. Here's the action item. I want to make sure we get here. You definitely, if you're selling something, have multiple packages, at least three.
You're listening to the Thrivetime Show.
Have one package. It's the big kahuna. It's expensive. It's premium.
The big kahuna.
Have one in the middle. Have one at the bottom. Most people will choose the middle. That's how you do it. By law of contrast, it seems like a better deal, the one in the middle. Tim, you've worked with business clients all over the world helping grow their companies. Have you ever seen this move work in packages?
Oh, yeah. It's very common. I believe in having a very high-end package because there's sometimes people says, hey, money is not an object. I'm going to do it all, you know.
Boom.
And so, boom. There you go. And
87
then you guys,
photographers.
Yeah, the money doesn't matter. And so, but it's so often where donations, when Oral Roberts would write these things, it would be like 1,000, 100, or, you know, they would manipulate this thing, but they would word it in a way where you're going to choose the middle one almost every time.
Oh, now here's a move. There was a bride I worked with.
So do you have three packages or three options that you offer in your product offering? That's what we're asking.
I have an hysterical example for you. Years ago, we did a wedding at the Mayo Hotel in the main foyer there, and a bride chose our biggest package. And our sales guy comes in and goes, she wants to go with the biggest, it's called the Cinderella's Ball. It's like a $4,000 DJ package.
No object.
And he's like, we don't even own those speakers. Like, that's not even a, how would we do that? I mean, because it's like two Sirwin Vegas, massive speakers, a margarita machine, a dance floor. I'm not kidding, all these things. And I'm like, dude, just do it. So I'm not kidding. We took what she paid, and we just bought everything cash. We bought a brand new margarita machine. We ended up doing. I'm not kidding. We had to buy so much extra stuff, and we're like, dude, someone actually bought it. So I go to Lori Montag, my wedding mentor of Montag Photography. I said, Lori, someone just bought my biggest package. What do you do? She goes, you got to like triple the price of that thing. And so every time that someone would ever go with the big kahuna, I always had to like.
Yeah, you had to up the price.
Up it up.
Honest to goodness, I am flying in this G4 jet from Hawaii to Seattle years ago. And I'm sitting down with a guy that owns this. And he buys companies. And he wanted to buy a 180-foot yacht. And he ended up buying the boat company.
Buying the boat company.
And he found that people with a $25 million to a $33 million purchase that he had, he said that is an impulse purchase for my client, for my ideal client, most likely buyer. Impulse.
Oh,
so it's just a different way of thinking here, but that's where some people are at.
So here's the deal, Thrivers. When we come back, we're going to get into this next manipulation move. And we're bringing on the founder of the Elephant in the Room Men's Grooming Lounge to join Tim and Z and I inside the box that rocks. This is Justin Moore. And he's opening up his he's the third location of Elephant in the Room, but he's actually opening up a fourth and fifth right now. He's wanting to grow more Elephant in the Room Men's Grooming Lounges. And full disclosure, he is my brother-in-law. So it'll be a shameless apologetics show. But no, in all sincerity, we're talking about the manipulation moves, how to inoculate yourself, how to protect yourself from them, and how to use them for good. It's a game-changing episode, Z. A game-changing episode.
I can see why this was. You were so excited about this episode as we got started.
It blew my mind. My mind is blowing my mind as we get into this. I'm going to put some duct tape on my cranium. Stay tuned.
My name is Brian Zimmerman. I'm from Castle Rock, Colorado. I own an e-learning platform that educates and teaches people how to start side incomes. There's a few things that I've learned here, one being just the ease in having a system of actually starting a business and then executing it, and then also being able to build systems around your entire process when it comes to building a successful business. I first heard about the Thrive business coaching platform through an ad or something I seen online, and I was a veteran, and so I was able to join their veteran program and start the Thrive program that way, and I've since become a coaching client and have worked with Thrive now for almost 2 years. I describe the overall workshop experience is phenomenal. It's great. I love the environment. I love the way that Clay presents and teaches. It's a way that not only allows me to comprehend what's going on, but he explains it in a way to where it just makes sense and it's an easy to follow process. For anyone that's ever been to the Thrive 15 headquarters, I would describe it as showing up to Disneyland only for business experience. It's an amazing place. The environment's great. The team is amazing. And even better, it's a really cool environment with the quotes and the different decor all over the place. This place is awesome. Yeah, I would describe Clay's presentation and teaching style as he's almost like he's a comedian, but he explains it in a way to where he adds humor and it's fun, it's exciting. It keeps you engaged. You don't feel like you're falling asleep or getting bored. There's a lot of conferences and other things that I've been to where it's like I'm itching to stand up. But it's almost here, I'm on the edge of my seat, and I'm engaged and I'm ready to learn at all times, and so it's been fun. The interaction level has been great. There's segments where there's breakouts to where Clay's ready, he's available to answer any questions. The communication between the other classmates has been great. I've learned different things from other members that have been here as well. So the engagement has been phenomenal. I love it, it's been great. For anyone that's never attended a Thrive 15 workshop, you're missing out on community, you're missing out on support. I think it's important to be able to step away from your business, and not only step away from your business, but to engage with other business owners so you can learn their perspectives, their ideas, and what it is that they're learning, and really get an altitude perspective of what it is that you're doing so you can see other ways to actually fix and correct what it is that you're doing so you can grow and build your business. The Thrive Conference is different from a lot of other seminars and trainings because there is no upsells. You're not expecting for that, oh, wait a minute, oh, here it comes, here's that pitch, and the next thing you know, people are running, standing up and running in the back of the room or worried about another sales pitch. There's none of that here. It's straight content, how you can build, how you can grow your business, and then you implement what it is that you can with your business, and then you execute it. I would recommend that other people attend the Thrive 15 workshop because if you're looking for an easy process to follow, a step-by-step system, and have support and guidance, this is where it's at. I have attended a lot of different trainings, a lot of different seminars, and I don't think there's been anything as easy to follow, at least for me, as this, not only the teaching style, but then the direction and then the implementation and the plans that they've laid out here at Thrive 15. Sunshine in my pocket, got that good soul in my feet, feel
that hot blood in my body when it drops. All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back into the conversation. It's the Thrive Time Show on your radio and inside the box that rocks. Dr. Z, we have some guests here. We have these disturbing youths of America. Many times people feel like I cannot become an entrepreneur until I'm like 50, till I'm 40. We've got two guys here that are sort of gainfully self-employed men. Can you kind of describe what you're seeing here for people who are not on Facebook Live?
Well, we've got both kinds of men on here.
Oh, really?
Yeah, we've got the GQ look over here with the tall, dark, and handsome former professional basketball player.
Yeah,
Marshall.
From Costa Rica.
Yeah, from Costa Rica. With the suit and the, you know, the look. And then
the look.
And then next to me, we've got a guy that just kind of rolled in, I think in a wagon and horse-drawn carriage. He looks like he's kind of Amish slash, you know, looking for an underpass. I don't know. I mean, he's got the hat. He's got this big beard on there, and he's kind of, you know.
Well, let's.
I think he brought some baked goods or something.
Okay,
with
so we've got Marshall Morris, one of the producers at the Thrivetime show, and we have Justin Morris. Let's start with Justin. Justin, defend yourself. We'll talk to him about the Amish look here.
Yeah,
explain to him what's going on. Convince
here,
him he's wrong.
This is definitely the look that I've chosen to go with, and to be honest. Everyone talks about it, so I'm doing something good here, right?
It's memorable.
It's memorable. That, seriously, and in business, yes. You got to be memorable. And so there's good and bad. But that guy with the hat, the beard, the Amish one, you know,
the
who
purple cow.
Him?
He's the purple cow. He is the purple cow. Yeah.
And he is the founder of Elephant in the Room. I teamed up with him to help him grow that thing. But Elephant in the Room, they have 3 locations, and he knows something about business growth, how to do it. He's been through hell and back to build that thing. This is year 5, right? Year 5?
Yeah, we're going back this time again.
Boom.
I don't know if you know that, but we're going back.
We're going from hell.
Another 5.
We're going from hell to back and then back to hell.
We're going back.
All right, nice. Yeah. That's
good. Up for another 5.
You want to keep it original. Back to the roots. Okay, now we have Marshall on the show. Now, Marshall, can you kind of explain your GQ-ness? I mean, you're a beautiful man, and then when you just decorate yourself like this, it just the ladies cannot get off Facebook Live.
Now, I am actually starting my beard. I'm starting the beard.
I was going
to
say something. I noticed that. Is that permitted in the office?
I don't know if it's in the handbook or not, but see, this haircut is actually a product of Elephant in the Room.
Oh, wow.
And so I'm like a walking advertisement for Elephant in the Room.
How has that changed your life on the radio here?
I'm still somehow single, but we're working on that. Hopefully Clay's shout-outs are going to work.
I tell you what, we've got Sam the Lumberjack.
Yeah, he's beautiful,
man. Marshall the GQ dude.
Mm-hmm.
I've got you rocking the hoodie.
Yep.
And your Make America Boom hat again.
Absolutely.
And I've got, you know, Justin over here, Amish boy.
And you got the soccer
and
jersey
I'm like
on.
The soccer dude over here. We got this room's full of testosterone, by the way. I mean, it's just absolutely packed full of testosterone.
Now, here is the deal. We're talking about the manipulation mechanisms that can be used to help you or to hurt you in the world of business. So we're moving on to move number 3. Here we go. When opportunities become scarce, we desire them more. Let me repeat one more time. When opportunities become scarce, we desire them more. So let me give you an example of the move.
The move. Here
so
it is.
In real estate, I've worked with many real estate agents over the years. And what you want to do in real estate is you want the buyer to feel like there are many people looking at that house. If you're in the real estate, if you're selling furniture, you want many people to feel like that the furniture could only be around for a few minutes, maybe a few weeks.
Oh yeah.
So here's the deal. There was two different furniture guys I worked with, one in Dallas, one in Tulsa. And I'm thinking about the one in Dallas. This is what he would do. I told him, I said, listen, if somebody ever asks about a sofa, you need to say, I know we have at least one of those in stock. Is that something you like? Yeah. Okay. Well, let's make a list of what else you like. And if it's something you like, you know, I'll just put it on hold. And then Friday I'll call you to make sure, you know, if you want to move forward. And if not, no stress. But I just want to make sure we don't sell that final one without talking to you, you know?
Sure.
And what it does is it creates a subtle little pressure. And the key is to say, hey, no pressure, but I want to make sure. I know we have at least one left. No pressure. But I know we have at least one left. I'll make sure I put that on hold for you. By saying no pressure, it gives you the ability to pressure people.
Yes, exactly. That's the beautiful part of it. It's no pressure.
So
you're saying pressure.
So it's like no offense.
Yeah.
So you're going out to dinner with some guys and a friend of yours. You've all Ubered. Okay, Z, maybe you cannot relate to this situation.
Okay, maybe
you've all Ubered to a restaurant with an English theme, let's say, okay? Mm-hmm. Everyone's had two shots of whiskey.
Okay.
And your buddy says this. Hey, Robert, no offense, but... And then he just goes off, and it sort of gives him an ability to say whatever he wants to say after that. These laws of manipulation, that's kind of some of these moves. Be careful. But here's the deal. Z, when you hear someone say, I only have, you know, this is the final item, the final choice. I hope we don't run out. What immediately goes through your mind now as a savvy buyer?
You think to yourself, well, one, it's obviously popular. I mean, I'm not the only one that likes this. Obviously, there's other people that have been buying it.
Mm.
Two, you know, if I really want that, I better make a commitment to it pretty quickly because it could be gone. I mean, you know, there's a part of your brain that always says, aren't they just saying that? And then there's a part of your brain that says, well, eventually they're going to get down to their last one. I mean, they're going to have it to where that's the last one. All we have is a floor model. I mean, they're going to get down to where it is their last one. And so, you're kind of going, hey, if I like it, and it's something, so, you know, you don't buy, you know, you don't buy a new couch every day.
Right.
It's something you buy and you keep for years.
Right.
So if you're sitting and thinking, you've been looking and you look at it and you go,
and then
you
have
like
at least
that.
One left.
And
you
have at least one
it's
left.
On hold.
So you're like, well, it doesn't hurt to put it on hold.
Right? Yeah. Oh. Yeah. Now you're kind of already in the game.
Now you're like, okay, oh, you know what? I appreciate that. Thank you. And then, yeah, I can sleep on it or I can look at some other stuff today. Yeah, put that on. Yeah, put that on hold. I don't want to lose that.
Oof.
And all of a sudden, now you're logically is over here. Now you're kind of getting emotional. You know, you're kind of going, well, wait a second. I don't want to lose it. I don't want to lose it. I'm competitive.
So here are here's an example of two examples. I want to get Justin's take on this and then Marshall's. So the McRib. They're always bringing it back one last time. The McRib.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, you're listening to the Thrivetime Show.
I don't know that I've ever wanted an artificially created McRib sandwich that has painted lines on it in the shape of grill marks that have never, this thing's never seen a grill. But when they say it's a limited time, the McRib is back, part of you wants to go,
I gotta have that.
I mean, this is
it's a limited time.
Before they take it away. This could be the last time.
This could be the last time.
Well, they do it every time. So you see the sign, limited time. So Justin, I want to ask you, here's kind of the tee up here. Elephant in the room, now that you are legitimately super busy all the time and you go downtown and it's like people will call to schedule a haircut and that you cannot get them in because you're already fully scheduled. Why do you think it is people now? I mean, you've seen it. Why do people want to schedule in advance now that they've seen that they cannot get in if they just show up last minute?
Yeah, so it's the whole supply and demand. So, you know, in the beginning, we gave the perception that we were already booked out. We were already a big deal before we were, right? Mm. And now we are seriously booked out. So I just talked to my man, Marshall over here,
anymore, huh?
And said, we've got to put some more hiring ads out. And he handles that for us. But you know, he said, are you firing or hiring? Both, okay? But seriously, so now the guys are realizing I really can't get in. And without mentioning names, he's gone through this and tried some people out.
Try to get in?
Because they're...
Yeah, they've closed me out. I've been like one of the original members and they're closing me out. What's up with that?
You got to book 2 months in advance for some people. So it's just that. And I go, do we need to raise the price? What do we do here? But... We definitely book people far in advance now, and that's what we want.
Now, Marshall, I'm going to give you a move here. I'm going to throw out a scenario for you. There was a girl I went to college with at Oral Roberts University who was a very attractive, smart person. But her move was is she always referred to some guy she was dating, but found out later she was never actually dating a man. Why did every man want to date the woman who was already dating a man? What was going on? You walk me into your single mind.
She was never available.
Ah.
She's never available, so you always want to date her.
Why?
But I don't know. So are you telling me that I need to make up up a girlfriend?
So I had a guy, we had a thing called Get Your Roommate a Date, and I had a friend named Jake, and Jake's like, I'm going to set you up. And I said, really? He goes, trust me, I've got a move. He goes, I call it the referral. And I'm like, you call this the referral? How does this work? He goes, watch it be done. I will tell you about it later. Just watch it be done. Watch the artist. So Jake walks up to this lady for Get Your Roommate a Date, and he says, here's the deal. My good friend Clay over here, he's in a relationship. It's totally not good. The girl just doesn't appreciate him. And this guy's going to be a millionaire someday. I'm just telling you, if you see this guy, hard worker, good guy. I'm trying to get your roommate a date. I got to convince, you know, a lady like yourself to go on a date. I got to find someone for my roommate. He's already dating somebody, but I think I could convince him to stop dating her. And I got to find somebody because he's not going to go because she's sort of a stick in the mud. You know what I'm saying? Would you go if I could? She goes, well, yeah, almost like thankful.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what did you do? He goes, and he tells me the story, and I'm like, that's a move. And he's
that
like, dude, she wants what she can't have, and she believes she can't have you, my friend. And even though you're a B, I got an A for you for the roommate date. I'm like, that's amazing.
That's amazing.
It's a move. It's a dark art of manipulation. Figuring out how to make it work for your business. It could be a good thing or a bad thing. Now, the next move number four.
Wait. You shared a story. You got to end the segment on the story where you had where you trained someone to move. And then they try to use it on you later, and you were like,
I called the furniture store, and I said, hey, listen, my wife wants to come in and get a bar stool. And he goes, hey, we're down to our final set. And I go, you know, I taught you the move. And he goes, I know, but it's just something I say now. I'm like, come on. You know, so it's kind of a deal of like, he just is so used to saying we're down to our final set without even checking.
Yeah, they don't even think about it. That's obviously the last one.
And we're talking, we come back, we're talking about this next manipulation mechanism, which is banned items and information are more desirable. The moment you put a banned warning label on that thing. People want that thing. That parental advisory sticker on CDs made every high school kid want to buy those CDs. Stay tuned. ThriveTimeShow.com.
I'm Jared Pawelka. I'm originally from Denver, but I live right here in Tulsa. So I have some friends that are involved in Thrive. They referred me to it just about 2 years ago. I'm involved in an investment banking business. We provide financial consulting around M&A, mergers and acquisitions, capital sourcing, and we also provide accounting and strategic finance consulting to business owners. Definitely just how important it is to drive early on in your business development, sales, and systematizing your strategy, sales and workflows. It almost couldn't get any simpler. It's no fluff. That's the first thing that comes to mind. No fluff. You're going to hit the ground running with practical business tips that cover the gamut, but we only really talk about what's relevant. There's a whole world of things that can confuse you, but we just really focus on nuts and bolts. It's easy to get here. It's you certainly pick up immediately in what's going on. You know, sometimes you kind of have to warm up to it. That's not going on here. You hit the ground running, and actually, if you're not paying attention, you might get left behind. Clay is he's funny, but he's brutal. I don't know if you can have that in the same person, but he is. Their humor is used to illustrate a point. So I describe Clay as, again, no fluff, someone who's direct and to the point, doesn't normally waste a lot of words to get to practical tips and ways to even customize it for your business. There's an opportunity to interact with him, which that's probably why you come here. So you're going to interact with fellow conference goers, thrivers, and Clay and part of his staff. So there's breaks. You're going to interact at, you know, deeper level in between, but you can raise your hand and ask questions on an interactive basis. It's not going to be a crowd of 5,000. So if you've never attended a Thrivetime workshop, you're missing a chance to really get down to brass tacks in a short time period. You know, you're going to spend 2 days, whereas it might be otherwise wasted at a lot of other conferences. You're going to come away, probably save yourself 5 years of business school. It's not a stretch to say save yourself maybe 5 years of business school in 2 days. So, you know, there's not a product to sell. There's value that you receive immediately. And I think there's ample opportunity for you to follow up, but you're going to sell yourself into different things. If you've enjoyed your time here, you'll be looking for more interaction from Thrive15.com, from the books that Clay and his mentors and people that he works with, they've all collaborated to create incredible products that you might have interest in afterwards. But in the conference itself, there's no upsell. You owe it to yourself. If there's such a thing as cheating yourself by not doing something, this is it. If you don't come and spend the investment in yourself and in your business, you're cheating yourself. That's what I would say to people. That's what you're missing out on. You don't know what you're missing out on. I'm telling you, I might even pay for your... It might be crazy to say, but I might even pay for your time here. It's that worthwhile. Glad to refer anybody to it.
All right, Thrivers, welcome back to the Thrive Time Show on your radio, where we're sneaking in some Counting Crows. Dr. Z, you love the Counting Crows?
I do. I love the Counting Crows.
Unbelievable. Their lyrics are surprisingly deep. I mean, if you listen to too many of their songs, you find yourself contemplating the meaning of life and just how you feel about how you feel. You maybe only get one Counting Crows song a week.
How I feel about how I feel?
It gets a little deep when you listen to that music.
That is deep.
I'm just telling you, you start burning incense. Next thing you know, you're living in a van down by the river. Just a warning, don't listen to more than two or three Counting Crows songs a week, unless you want to start writing poetry.
Speaking of burning stuff, why have we had any pinion wood burning here of late?
I think we're out of those pinion sticks.
Oh, we are?
And so we need to probably order some of those, and it's just kind of a move here. Sam, that's got to be on the checklist. Sam, our executive producer, is putting that on the pinion list. Okay, here we go. So here we go. We're talking about the mechanisms for manipulation. These can be used for good and for bad, and so you want to be cautious. You want to caution yourself. You want to be aware as a buyer, but as a salesperson, you want to figure out how you can ethically use these moves for you. So here is move number four. Banned items and information are seen as more desirable. So I'll give you two examples. Remember that book that was written, it's called like Health Secrets the Government Doesn't Want You to Know About?
Yeah.
Or government grants they don't want you to know about, yeah, or real estate secrets that they don't want you to know. It's always those late night infomercials. But because they do not want you to know, you want to know. Z, why do we want to know whatever we're not supposed to know? What is the deal?
Something just that's part of the these little manipulative moves, and that counteracts, that bypasses the logic in our brain. And then we just, because I think we're just curious creatures by nature. You know, we're just kind of like, what is that? I mean, if you hand someone a box, you're like, just don't open that.
I can't stand it.
I can't criticize
the father of the universe, but I want to know if God had read, you know, these moves, and he was like, what I'll do is I'll tell Adam he cannot have this apple, because I know as soon as I tell him he can't have it, he's going to be like, I want it. It's the banned apple. So, Justin, I want to get your take on this. You're an entrepreneur, you know what I mean? And you've kind of seen the sales moves. You've seen the game a little bit. From your perspective, why do people always want to get what they're not supposed to have? Or if something's banned or it's an item you shouldn't have, why do people want it? What's going on?
So if you create that elite club that you know, you go to the restaurant, the bar, the seating that someone paid extra, you know, the roped off area. Well, I want to go to the roped off. It's just right over there. It's the same level, everything, but it's got the red rope. You got to cross the red rope. You got to pay the guy extra, right? It's the limited availability.
My son asked. We're hopping on the plane, and he goes, "Dad, why do they put that first class drape up? Why do they put that thing? It's like see through. I can see them. They can see me. Who cares if they're in coach or first class?" He's 9, and I'm like, "When you shut the gate, and you shut that little, it's like a drape, it's like a curtain that separates you between first and second class, you know, on the plane, between so coach."
It's the same material that they issue for rec basketball games that you wear as a jersey, as a penny. You can just see right through it.
As soon as they shut that and you feel like, I wish I would have worked harder, all of a sudden you want to sit 4 feet further ahead. You're I wish I would. I think I don't know if the curtain says now you should have worked harder, but it kind of feels like that. You should have worked harder. And so that's the way that happens. So we're moving on to this move number 4, right? The banned items. So I remember when I was in high school, this is the song that was playing. I'm going to cue it up here for you, okay? So it's Dr. Dre. He's the guy who built the Beats headphones. And this is the edited version, so calm down, Thrivers. But here we go. So when Snoop Dogg and Dr. Dre would make an album, and it would have the parental advisory sticker on it, we all wanted to have it because you shouldn't have it. Now, the thing is, Al Gore, his crowning achievement, in my opinion, as the vice president, he worked with his wife, Tipper Gore, and he's responsible for the parental advisory sticker. I don't know if you know that. Al Gore's wife, that's her number one achievement, was making the parental advisory sticker. And I felt like as soon as I saw an album come out, like NWA or Dre that had the parental advisory, every kid wanted it. Z, you were a parent at the time. I mean, talk to me about it. When you know your son wanted the parental, your sons wanted the parental advisory albums when they saw that warning. What is it, man? What's going on in the human head?
You know, the thing about it is we here, like you said, we want the thing that we're not supposed to get. We want that because part of it is like, I wonder what bad words they have on there. I wonder what they're saying.
I wonder what they're saying.
I wonder what it is. You know, and then they're curious. And that curiosity, it's like I said, you give someone a box and you say, hey, that's got something in it really precious, but don't open it. I mean, how long do you think they'll stare at that box before they open it? Well, they can't stand it. You can't stand it. And it's a move. And it's a move that you can use for your business in a positive way. We're going to teach you, we're going to come over a few of those. Or the dark arts way. It's almost like they probably figured out that, hey, throw a few cuss words in there, put the parental advisory on there, and we're going to sell more CDs, i.e. albums. Right?
Yeah, here's the deal. I remember going on a timeshare tour back in the day to Vegas.
Oh, gosh.
And I went with my wife, and this was back in the day before we could afford to go to Vegas, but we still went. And
so
my move was I decided, you know what, I can't afford a show, I can't afford a buffet, I can't afford anything, but I'll just go on as many timeshare tours as I can, and they'll give you free tickets and a buffet in exchange for your time.
Yes.
So Vanessa looks at me and she goes, if you guys ever been on the strip before, I mean, there's timeshares people everywhere. Vanessa goes, you signed us up for 4 timeshare tours? Because each one's like a 4-hour tour, and we'd never done one before. I'm like, yeah, how long could it be? I mean, it's like an hour probably, you know? Well, these timeshare guys know all of these moves.
Oh, they know them all.
And so I remember going through this process, and the guy goes, now here's the deal. We only have 1 unit left currently. I know it seems hard to believe. We only have 1 unit left, and it's a deal where because the building's already paid for, they're going to sell it where it's just such an amazing deal. I just I don't even want to waste your time looking at it. I mean, because it's a deal where it's such a little price, it's almost unbelievable, and it's just it's such a no-brainer. I don't want people like I'm manipulating you guys. And he's just saying this. So we're like, can you show it to us? You know, because we're like a 19-year-old. I guess we're 21 at the time. Like, could we see it? And he's like, well, I don't want to waste your time. If you guys can't afford to do it, I mean, it's such a low price, and there's everyone wants it, and we have one left. I'd rather just show it to the next couple. I mean, they're probably – and he's like, hey, Craig, do they want to see it now, or are they wanting to see it later, or what's the deal? And he's like, yeah, they want to see it now. And he's like, well – and I'm like, just show it to us. So we go in this room, and we go into this – he walks us into this room, this timeshare, and all of a sudden you want the room because you can't have it. It's like the final thing. There's that pressure. And so Vanessa looks at me. I remember sitting down at this table, this boardroom table, and she's like, we should do it right now because we're going to be sold out by noon. And all of a sudden, I'm like, no, I know what is happening. I don't know exactly what's happening, but I feel like we should not buy this now.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, you're listening to The Thrivetime Show.
It's like the slap sequence in Groundhog Day with Bill Murray. You know, he was manipulating her, and then, but somewhere inside of her brain, she finally snapped too, and then she'd just slap him, you know, scene after scene after scene. I was in an art gallery just the other day, last week.
An art gallery.
And they had this bronze statue that was really, really cool. I need to show you a picture of it over the break, Clay and guys. But it had this little horse, but it was life size. And he was kind of leg spread, and his nose was down the ground. And on the ground was this bronze turtle. And they were really highly decorated and painted. And they're really cool. I mean, really cool.
I have audio from your trip real quick. This is what was playing when you saw it.
I did. I was like, oh, that's just so clever. It's so cool. It's so good. So I go up to the dude. He just got the long hair, kind of surfer looking dude behind the counter. I'm like, bro, how much is the horse? And looks at me and goes, oh, I got a deal for you. And I was like, oh, cool, what is it? And he goes, here's the thing. You buy the turtle for $97,000, and you get the horse free. But wait, the artist only made 25 of them.
25.
And that's the 25th one. Who would have thought that I sold the other 24? But that's the last one. And you know, when they sell out of a thing, it'll probably double, triple in price.
You know, I had audio of what you said to the guy, and I know it seemed weird because when you went to this art auction, you know, you go to this art gallery, a lot of times you're like, Clay, we have a radio show we do 2 hours a day, yeah, but it's not ethical for you to record me without my knowledge. And I'm always talking, I'm saying, hey, look, I know that's what you've said, but I feel like you would have wanted me to have been there.
Oh, okay.
So I've secretly mic'd your phone. I've worked with the Russians to tap your phone.
Sure.
And this is what you said to the guy.
No, you know what I did is I sat there and I listened to him. And of course, since it was the slow month of the art gallery, you know, he knocked another like 10 grand off and said he could store it indefinitely or ship it free and no sales tax because I was out of state. And I mean, he had all the moves and I was just impressed. I sat there and I thought, you know, that's a very good job. I didn't purchase the turtle, therefore getting the horse free, but I was impressed by his moves. The guy had it down pretty good.
I almost wanted to stick around and take notes.
Yeah, I was like, I just wanted to go, you know, well done, buddy.
Now,
well
here's
done.
The deal. Now, I want Justin to chime in on this one because this is a big one. We have an elephant in the room, okay? This is a big one here. This is a big one. Elephant in the room, Justin's worked very hard to create kind of like a country club of men's hair. It's a very high-end atmosphere, but it's a place where anybody can get to. You don't have to be like a super high roller to get in there, but it's a nice experience. It's a high-end feel, and he wants to make sure the level of conversation matches the decor. We don't have a bunch of sailors in there fighting, cursing each other out. It doesn't feel like a seedy bar in there. It doesn't feel like it's a pirate show in there, okay? And so we have a lot of clients. When we first started and Justin was establishing the rules of decorum and how to handle yourself, on a golf course, you shouldn't make cell phone calls. You know, you shouldn't, like, talk loudly. It's kind of a peaceful atmosphere he's trying to create. Well, this is this next move. It says, we are near obsessed with being and appearing consistent in our words and actions. So, Justin, you'd have a guy who would come in who would profess to be a family man, right, a good guy, and he would come in and just drop a buffet of curse words inside the shop. And you somehow had to appeal to their higher morals or higher values to get them to stop without, I mean, how did you, you know, because there's certain clients that would talk about inappropriate subjects and you didn't want to make it uncomfortable. How did you appeal to their higher motives to get them to, you know, calm down without kicking them out of your shop?
Yeah, so anytime you get a group of people together, you're going to wind up on some amazing conversations and and wonder, how did I get on this topic? What are we talking about here? What is this even appropriate? You know?
Right.
And so the whole goal was, you know, ultimately we're cutting hair, we're providing grooming services for men. And so over the 30, 40 minutes, we need to connect with these guys. We need to build rapport. So we came together and we created our four: family, occupation, recreation, enjoyment. And we want to keep it on a healthy, uplifting conversation. So one of our rules is no negativity in the shop.
And I saw Justin, he would say this. He'd go, hey, I know you're a great guy, you're a great dad, and I know you don't want to be talking about these things in front of all these other people. So if we can just kind of keep it to your standard you're used to, that'd be great. And he'd have to kind of correct people at first because people felt like they found this undiscovered country where they could just curse like sailors and no big deal. And I'm saying is that people want to be consistent. Like, people don't want to be, you know, somebody who appears to be inconsistent. So the main thing is you're working with your customers, you're working with people and buyers and sellers, just understand that most people are obsessed with the idea of being consistent and having high integrity. And if you appeal to their higher motives, as a general rule, you can get people to behave at a higher standard. Even if you're an HR director, you can say, hey, I know you're a good person, and I know typically you don't make bad decisions, and I know you're typically known as a person who makes good decisions. So I would like for you to continue that reputation and just kind of, you know, step up that game to the next level. But Justin, you've been great at that with employees and with customers.
Yeah, so we've gotten rave reviews. And like I said, we have a team of about 70 people now. So just by me being that bully and being consistently encouraging people as far as the positive conversations, we've learned to attack the subject and not the person. So if it's language, if it's a mindset, so we always think and speak positively of each other and what we're doing. And then it reflects in our clients. They don't even realize they're having a healthy conversation. And so instead of saying, you will abide, you will stop cursing, because after year one, it was a
little bit of a pirate hangout.
The F word, all that stuff was flying.
Every
there
guy was cursing in there all the time. We just allowed it down.
Yeah.
Now, here's the deal, Thrivers. If you're listening right now and you have staff, you have employees, you have team members, and you want them to behave at a high standard, Dr. Z and Marshall, both of which you handle hiring a lot of people, are going to teach us how you can appeal to a higher motive to hold people to a higher standard by just appealing to their own desire to live up to their own reputation. There's a way to do it. Z, I want to get your feedback. Marshall, I want to get your feedback. Stay tuned. ThriveTimeShow.com. ThriveTimeShow.com.
Hi, I'm Jeff Finn. I'm from Wichita, Kansas with Augustino Brewing Company. So my business partner told me all about Thrive. At first, I thought he was kidding, but being here, it's real deal. Being here, I'm learning that systems is a number one thing that you've got to have. Without the systems, you can't be successful. There's a lot of energy that goes on around here, and it's something that you feel all the way through, even during breaks. This place is pretty relaxed. People here, they greet you every morning. They're welcoming you into the facility, and it's got a vibe that's really just relaxed. It feels really nice to be in this building. Clay's definitely got a lot of energy. It's something where, you know, he's telling you something, you can feel his passion. It's something you're taking away a lot of information, and he's condensing this down, but boy, it's something that's down to earth, and you're just walking away knowing that you've got the information you need to be successful. So far, the workshops have been delivered in such a way that, you know, the audience is asked to contribute. It might be something of reading from the book, you know, one of the notable quotables, or asking the questions. He's always prompting for questions. People who haven't ever been to a Thrivetime conference, they're missing a lot of information that could help them take their businesses to the next level. So with Thrivetime, there's no upsell. Another thing that you get with this conference compared to others, there's a desk. Thrivetime, I think, is going to be a big benefit to me and my organization. I'm going to be able to take this information back and apply things immediately.
Z, it is a beautiful day inside the box that rocks. I'm telling you what, there's something about it. It's a beautiful day, and I'm glad that you, too, see the beauty of this day. You know what I'm saying? I'm so glad that you, too, see the beauty of this day, this beautiful day.
I think that was the intro song. You kind of, it's called Beautiful Day, and it's by the band U2. Is that why you were saying that?
I am trying to put your mind in a blender right now. Just
you're trying to circumvent my logic synapses?
Now, Z, we have a lot of Thrivers who've been reaching out to us, emailing us, saying, hey, what is your in-person Thrivetime workshop all about?
Yeah, yeah,
and so who are we to withhold this knowledge? You know what I mean? So I'm going to get into the details. You tell me if I'm missing something, okay? So here's the deal. First off, they're affordable for everybody. So
well, how is that possible?
Well, we have
because they're like $500.
We have a scholarship program. So what happens is like I remember my brother-in-law Justin and I. We went to a Justin Bieber concert.
Sure did.
And Justin helped us upgrade that. So we're sitting like on what row 7 or 8, something like that, right?
Close enough to see Bieber lip sync.
And it was expensive tickets, and we were able to pay the. We were able to pay for the close enough to see him lip sync. We were able to pay enough money though. We could afford to sit there, so we're blessed to be able to sit that close. However. However, if we couldn't afford it, you couldn't just walk up to the front person and say, hey, I cannot afford to sit close. For Jim Gaffigan, I sat on like row 6, okay? You couldn't go, hey, although I do not have the money to sit on row 6, I have a desire to sit on row 6. And they would go, sure, here, let me escort you down. That's not how it works. But we have an in-person workshop, and our whole goal is to help you become a successful entrepreneur. We know the power. We've seen guys like Justin, guys like Marshall, be able to build successful things, be able to gain traction in the world of business. It's fun to see that. And so we've set up a scholarship program. And so if you can't afford it, Marshall, you've met people at the workshops that couldn't afford the full price.
Absolutely.
Talk to me about the kinds of feedback we've heard from them on the video. If you Google Thrive 15 conference reviews, or you watch the video reviews on YouTube, or you read the Google reviews, what kind of feedback have you seen these people have?
So these business owners, they're going on Google, they're Googling business conference or affordable business conference. And if you Google Thrive 15 reviews, you can hear what they have to say about it. But I know that I have specifically been pulled aside multiple times, and I know that you have too, where the business owner has been saying, hey, you know what? I want to just let you guys know, I really appreciate you making this affordable for me, because what I learned here over the past 2 days has been a game changer for my business.
And you know what happens is a lot of people, we were talking about these laws of manipulation today and moves you can use to help your business and that could you gotta be mindful of. And we had one thriver from California pulls me aside, and we had another thriver from Nashville. Two guys pull me aside. The guy from Nashville goes, so it's day 2, and he goes, "Hey, I gotta be real with you. This is after you spoke." He comes up and he says, "That was awesome." He goes, "When are you guys gonna do the whole upsell thing?"
And really?
Yeah, and I said, "We're not gonna do the upsell thing." And he goes, "No, but seriously, I've been to a lot of these things. Great nuggets. I'm learning a lot of stuff. I just want to when's that coming? I mean, how's your?" And I go, "It's not coming." And at the end, he just stood. He's like shocked. Like when it ended, he's like, "This was awesome." So he couldn't really contain it. So he just goes on the Google and he writes this huge review about his experience. And that happens over and over. So see, what kind of stuff do we cover at our in-person two-day Thrivetime workshops that people can find out? By the way, you can find out more at thrivetimeshow.com March 24th and 25th. You just have a few days left to get those tickets. See, what kind of stuff can people learn?
Well, I tell you what, you show up and you get your very own Boom book.
Boom.
Are you charging? That cost extra. No. You get your own Boom book, and we go over 13 principles of business, the 13 steps, the 13 super moves of business. And you know, a lot of times people will show up to the in-person workshop and they'll be like, I'm coming here because I know something's wrong with my business. It's not growing. Mm. It's not growing. And if it's not growing, it's decaying, right? So a lot of times people show up and say, I didn't even know what I didn't know. You know, and we go over time management.
Time management. Lee Cockrell's time management system, the guy who used to manage Walt Disney World, his system.
Marketing.
We go over the entire marketing step by step, the three-legged marketing stool. People say, how did Dr. Z become Tulsa's most successful optometrist, arguably?
There's
I would say he exfoliates his skin. He's beautiful. It's luck. It's genetics. No, he has a system that he's used and beauty.
It's true. Boy, you always give me such great lead-ins, Clay. I do.
That's I care.
Appreciate that so much. But we also go over branding. What is branding?
I mean, how do you improve the brand? How do you improve the look? Example, a rustic cuff. When you buy a rustic cuff, it comes in a beautiful box. It's great decor. You show up at the Elephant in the Room Men's Grooming Lounge. By the way, your first haircut is $1. First haircut is $1. You go in there. The branding is awesome. Justin's done a great job refining his brand. And you know what? Branding, your logo, your business card, your website, blah, blah, blah. Where do you start? We'll show you how to do that.
Yeah, and that's just the tip of the iceberg. We go over the 13 steps, and I tell you what, we give you downloadables, templates. You know, you can bring up to 3 members of your team, included in the $500. It's not $500 a piece. And like we said, with the scholarships, there's really no excuse not to do it. And if you're serious about starting or growing your business, I tell you what, you need to come to one of these in-person workshops. You know, we also have Thrive15.com. That is $1 your
$1? How could it be a dollar?
If you can't afford that, oh, gosh, I'm so sorry. But it's $19 every month after that. And it's basically, I like to call it and refer to it as the Netflix of business coaching. So you can get on there and do search any topic you need to in your business. And there we have a video, yes, a video really well done of a mentor, a successful person across the United States of America that we've, you know, we found and walked him onto the team, and now we videotaped him. And you can watch videos and get business coached with guys that you'd like to hang out with.
Example, the guy who did all the PR for Michael Jackson and for Pizza Hut. You know, who is that person?
Who is that person?
It's Michael Levine, and he is one of our teachers. Marshall, you've talked to thrivers all over the world. You've talked to a guy in Wichita with a coffee house. You've talked to a guy in Canada with a mortgage company. You've met thrivers all over the planet, people in New York, people in Florida. Why should somebody get out to our in-person workshop?
Okay, the in-person workshops are going to be incredible for anybody listening to this because it's going to be 16 hours of practical action steps for your business. So we're not talking about esoteric, vague, ambiguous business principles with no action items.
Nah.
The average attendee is going to leave with about 6 to 8 months worth of action steps from the workshop. And you get to ask all of your specific questions. This isn't one of those deals where you don't get to ask your question. You're just one person in a sea of thousands of people bashing beach balls around. But rather, you get to ask your questions to the people that are speaking here at the workshop.
But I like beach balls.
Now, let me walk you through. Now, this next move, we're going to teach this, our final move, we're going to kind of marinate on this move during the final segment, is a lot of times when you're listening to something like this, you see something like this, you encounter something like this. If you don't have, you're kind of uncertain, what you'll typically do is you'll look for social proof. Now, if you have truth on your side, the law of credibility will work on your behalf. So as an example, the elephant in the room, Men's Grooming Lounge that Justin started, now has thousands of members. And many people, I track the traffic, many people per day go to EITRLounge.com. And then once they go there, they leave the site and they go and read reviews. And then they come back and book their haircut because they're looking for third-party social proof that it is a proven good investment of their time. Even though the first haircut's a dollar, people don't want to waste their time. And once they've seen reviews from great people like you, they then come back and we ask them to reciprocate, going, hey, if you had a great time today, please share your feedback. And so we come back. We're going to talk about how to harness social proof. How is Justin doing it? How has Dr. Z done it? How does Marshall do it? How would Marshall recommend for you to do it as a business coach? How to harness the power of social proof to grow your business fast. Stay tuned. ThriveTimeShow.com. See the thorn twist
in your side. My name is Keith Schultz. I'm with Witness Security. I'm from here in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I first heard about the Thrivetime workshops, you know, through Clay Clark. He's been working with my business now for fairly close to 3 months. It's been a phenomenal experience of him being able to teach us his methods and processes just on a one-to-one basis. And then he talked about the workshops on his radio program, so therefore we decided to come. A few things that we've learned is just the simple basics of, you know, how to do sales appointments and how to convey your thoughts to our future clients and be able to help them decide what they need as far as their security needs. And also just the basics of the internet and how to function that and make that work for you in a business. Also as far as not only the internet, but just a general roundabout business principles that you need to convey to everybody so that people will call. The overall Thrivetime experience that I've experienced here, not only is it just exciting, just the way that it's mixed with just funny stories, funny real stories to be able to help people understand that, you know, building a business is hard work. And not only is it hard work, but it is rewarding if you follow through with the same principles and methods that he puts forth. If you choose not to do so, then you probably choose to fail. His teaching style is amazing out of the fact that he's able to tell stories that not only are they real, but they're funny, but yet at the same time, teach them with a principle that we can apply to each and every day-to-day practice in whatever business it is. So therefore, if you take these principles that he applies, you know, through the stories that he conveys and everything, it's virtually a guarantee that they'll work. What are they missing if they never attend? They miss the opportunity to be able to go out on their own. They miss the opportunity to be able to do things for their families and be able to have the time that they need for the things that they want to do. I've attended a few workshops in the time or conferences in the past, but as a rule, they do have something that you're gonna have to buy in the end. That's the thing about this. There is no buying at the end. Either you take the principles that he provides to you with and the methods that he provides to you at no cost, for the most part, and make them work for you, then there is no upsell. He provides you the materials for you to do the work. And if you choose not to do the work, that's between you and whoever. But he's not trying to sell you anything. He's just trying to help you. I'd recommend just about anybody, and I have recommended in the last 3 months, I've recommended dozens of people to at least listen to the program and try to apply some of the things they talk about on the Thrivetime show. And if you do, I guarantee it'll work. Just got to apply them.
All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back into the Inspiration Conversation, into the Audio Dojo of Mojo, the show that is focused on making your wallet grow. It's sort of that knowledge that you typically do not get in college. Dr. Z, when you graduated from the fine institution where you learned optometry and you studied mathematics.
Yes, yes.
I definitely know they prepared you to be a successful optometrist in terms of the technical aspects. I know that you learned quite a bit about math. I know you learned a lot about life. You probably learned a thing or two about a thing called love. But did they teach you how to grow a successful company at the college that you attended?
Well, it's kind of embarrassing, but my practice management, which is the class that gets you ready for business.
Business.
Business 101.
Oh.
I was given a couple of tips.
Okay.
And the tips went something like this. First of all, you should have your business card as much white on it as possible.
As much white
on
your
black.
As much white on the business card as possible.
That's step one of the three-step process to
being
successful.
This is huge. I'm writing this down. Huge.
Because that denoted class and that denoted professionalism.
Wow, this is you're going to pump up my business. I'm going to make as much white space as I can on every card. It's huge.
Huge. The more white, the better. Very little black on there, okay?
No black on the card. I got it.
Step two. The sign on your business, on your front door, your business needs to be small.
You want a small, why you want big biceps? You want to have a lot of white space. Why would you want a small sign? Why would you want that?
That denotes professionalism. That denotes just a subtlety of I'm here.
In our wussness.
You did good to find me.
Okay.
Congratulations. You have found the place.
Small sign.
And number three, I'm embarrassed to say, but this is the
true.
This was like
a lot of white space on the card.
Years ago. Yeah,
small sign.
A lot of white on the door. A lot on your card.
Okay.
And the third step was you joined the largest church in town, and you became one of the guys that passed around the buckets. I'm not kidding you. Those were the,
you became
those
a bucket three, passer outer moves.
Those were the three secret power moves of having a successful
here's
optometry
how I think,
business. I'm not kidding.
Here's how I think your optometry mastermind, entrepreneurial mind process this. You're going, guys, here's the deal. We've got 27 dudes. I will pay you guys $20 an hour to go out there and pass around the offering plates. Each one of you will wear a Dr. Robertson and Associates shirt.
And you'll answer to Robert, okay, or Dr. Z.
The pastor's like, hey, it's a little bit shady. We shouldn't be paying people to do this job. No, but seriously, so if you are going, okay, I have definitely graduated from college. Check the box.
Boom.
I've got some student debt.
Boom.
I don't know the first thing about starting a business. Guess what? You, my friend, are in good. It's I hate to say it, but you're in the majority. You are somebody who's not an idiot. You're most people.
Well, here's the thing that happens. You've got to understand, you know.
Tell us what it is, dude. According to Forbes.
What does it say?
You
Forbes?
Can Google this. It's a thing. Go ahead and Google.
Come on over.
It's G-O-O-G-L-E.
That's nice.
It's
Google. Nice. Nice. Very nice.
80%.
That's a big number.
A business is a startup.
Just put the number in there.
A swimming with the fishes.
Swim with the fishes. What? What? Swim with the fishes?
Yeah, someone met him with the shovel and they buried him.
Why do you got that?
Out in the desert.
Why do you always carry the bleach and the shovel and the lead pipe?
What's
wrong with you?
The thing about it is 8 out of 10 businesses that start, yeah, and some, I'm telling you, you can Google this, folks. Some people even have it as 9 out of 10, as high as 9 out of 10 businesses that start. And, you know, start businesses, there's a lot of work. I mean, there's a lot of money, a lot of time, a lot of emotion, a lot of, here we go.
Mabel and I spent all weekend making that small sign. It's a huge deal making a business. I mean, next thing you know, you got people running around going, what do I do? And people always asking all these questions like, how much are we going to get paid? See, starting a business could take several minutes.
Yeah, no, it takes a long time. And then when you put on a fail rate of 80% to 90%, that is just intolerable. We are going to stamp that out with
over
this
here.
Show.
I'm getting sad.
I know, it's crazy.
I came for help. You didn't. Someone give me a hug or something.
I need some help. I don't want that. But that's one of the things about it is that people are ill-equipped. They don't know what they don't know. And that's why when you came to me a couple, 3 years ago and you said, hey, listen, I'm loving business coaching, but I can only do a limited number of businesses. I'm turning business away because I've only got so many hours in the day, and my family actually wants to spend time with me.
And the whole
which is a little odd.
And the whole non-compete was a huge thing. This is a thing I still have problems with today. As I'm helping people grow their business, and they're dominating, and then their competitor reaches out. Their competitor says, "Hey, could you help me?" And I'm a good guy, and I'm also an opportunist. And I'm going,
yes,
hey,
you are both those.
And I'm going, hey, you know what? I want to help you, and I also want to make the money. And so you kind of feel bad when you're trying to help two of the same niche, so you don't. And then you're like, should I? And it's just, we got to scale it.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, you're listening to the Thrive Time Show.
So when you approached me about scaling, and you said, here's what we need to do. We need to find GOATs, greatest of all times in their industry, in their segment, okay? We broke it down. We had kind of the wheel, and we broke it down in about 20 different compartments, boom, 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 boom. Some, you know, we've kind of gone back and forth on that, but call it 20, okay?
Yep.
And then what we said is, let's go find people that are experts in that area. Let's videotape them. Let's make it fun. Let's chop them up into like 15-minute videos, and then we can sell it like Netflix subscription style, and then that way people can have an access, even if they have a dollar up to $19 a month, they can get some business coaching that they need, that they require, that they've got to have.
People are cheering right now. It's unbelievable.
We've got a whole yes, they are. I can
hear them. So I'm gonna first tee this up, then I want to get Justin's take on this, okay? You, to me, you don't know this, but Vanessa, when she worked, you know, as your front desk person slash the test prepper, she would prep the human eye for the visit with the doctor. She would help, dilate the pupil? Is that what she's doing?
Puff air.
Yeah. She was prepping. She was doing what we call pre-testing. And doing the, kind of like when you go to the doctor, the nurse, it measures your height and your weight and takes your blood
pressure.
So
here's the deal.
All that kind of stuff, yes.
Getting a chance to meet with you for lunch answered probably 2 years of questions where I was stuck that I couldn't move past. I didn't know. I read all the books and I didn't know what to do. And I just asked you question, line item, and I went and did it. And it was like, bam, I have all the answers.
Well, it's amazing because it's, you know, you almost think, well, it's self-evident. That's just obvious. That's, well, duh, that's how you do it. And yet, if you don't know, you don't know.
So mentorship has been huge for me. I mean, you have mentored me. So, Justin, I want to ask you, as you built Elephant in the Room, how big of a part has it been for you to have mentors or people that have kind of helped you along the way? How big of an impact have mentors made in your life building your business?
So at the age of 26, when I was at rock bottom, someone give me some music here. But
oh,
but
wow.
26, right? And so I surrounded myself with people that couldn't help me where I wanted to go, right? So I approached you, Clay, similar maybe to you approach Dr. Z. And I had this vision, this idea, this dream, okay? And you weren't 100% into this dream, this idea of this men's grooming lounge. And you shot it down time after time, right? But it was my approach was wrong. So once you said, let's go with this, it was 2 years of mentorship, opening businesses, 4 a.m., meet your house, driving to work.
You shouted me to work every day. I made you get to work at the same time that I got to work every day.
The notebook.
The notebook, baby.
Okay? Notebook after notebook, just writing everything. What did he eat for lunch? How long was he in the bathroom for?
What was he doing?
How fast does he walk? Right, everything, seriously. And I realized that I walked slow. I really walked slow.
I do remember
and
that.
I said, if someone who is successful makes more money than me, I need to walk fast, right? And then utilize your car as a mobile office. Always
true.
Calling people. You weren't catching up the newest hip-hop song, rap song, right?
Always motivational right? trainings or sales trainings, or I was making sales calls.
This is our Rocky. We were, right? And we just climbed day after day.
Boom.
Building that brain muscle, right?
Yep.
Because I didn't know where to start. And you guys just talked about your up-and-coming seminar you guys are having. I actually, I think it was at the Chamber of Commerce that I went to, and they helped me. But you helped me, actually.
Now, when we come back, Thrivers, Marshall Morris, business coach, will talk to you about the power of mentorship. Stay tuned.
My name is Mel Wright, and I am from Tulsa, Oklahoma. I am a photographer for family and weddings and portrait photography. My head is so full of things, I don't even know where to start. Basically, I have learned that I need to stay focused and be motivated and make checklists and actually do those things. And I have learned that I need to make a really good website, get reviews for my website, get on Google Maps and like have a location that people can see, have testimonials, have reviews. The Thrive 15 headquarters is amazing. It's like this big open space with lots of natural light, lots of like knickknacks all around that inspire clay, and lots of quotes that are just inspiring. And it's a fun, upbeat office. Clay's presentation style is really entertaining and motivational. He is so lively and really, really good at communicating to people all of the knowledge in his head. He has so much about business and running a business and having a successful business in his mind that he can just like really communicate with the average person. So the interaction at the speaking event with Clay is very personal. He's like right there, right in front of you. We're all sitting at desks and we have like a book. He gives you a book to write notes in, and it's like his own book that he wrote. And he is going through it with you step by step, letting you ask questions, answering those questions, giving examples, writing on a whiteboard. He's got videos. He's got lots of like visual and emotional and like sound that you can really learn everything he's telling you. So Clay's business workshop will not try to upsell you. He literally is just full of information and knowledge and just wants to share it with you and answer your questions. He's not gonna try to upsell you. He really just wants you, any motivated person, to be better. And it's not a scam. It's just a really amazing learning experience. I would recommend this workshop to anyone who is even just remotely thinking about having their own business, because it takes your mindset from, well, this is gonna be a lot of work and impossible and I'll never be successful at it, to, I could do this. I could absolutely do this.
I wanna dedicate this song to my beautiful wife of 15 years, my incredible brown-eyed girl, the lady who has been the mother of our five kids. She's been a chicken rancher. She's been a great Oklahomie, and she's put up with me for a long time. I mean, I remember when we first got married, I was trying to learn to become the not likes to fight guy, because I used to be likes to fight guy. And here's how likes to fight guy processes the earth. If you stare at likes to fight guy, or you look at likes to fight guy, or you step on his shoes, if you ever step on his white shoes, which I'm wearing now, white, you give her a step on his white Adidas, he's gonna box you. And I remember I just got married and I just mentally committed, I'm not going to fight people anymore. I'm not gonna do it. And so we go to Target and there was a lady in line. I remember I set my items on the conveyor belt. I set them on the conveyor belt. You know, Target, what you do is you have that little divider thing you can set out.
Oh yeah.
What do you call that thing? It's like a little divider, like a plastic.
Like a divider thingy. Yeah, a divider.
Okay. So you put that down, and this demarcates that this is where your groceries are and this is where mine are. So she had already gone through the checkout. She's going to swipe her credit card. I set down my thing. I put the line of demarcation down. And what happens is she looks at me and she goes, like that. And I remember going, what? And she looks at me and she goes, she looks at the cashier, but she talks about me to the cashier. She goes,
oh, yeah.
People today are just so disrespectful.
Yeah,
and I'm there with my wife. And I still have not fully embraced the not likes to fight guy. And I'm like, I've been married for like maybe a month. And I look at her and she goes, and she just keeps talking to the cashier. She goes, I'm telling you what, kids today, they just have no respect. I just can't even believe. And she's talking about me, but I am like within like 4 feet. What? And I said a series of horrible statements that made the woman cry, and then I followed her out of Target and continued yelling at her.
No, you helped her with
her groceries. You mean you helped her with her groceries out to her car?
No. I yelled at her, and I just attacked her. And my wife was like, baby, stop. And I just go for it, and I got back in the car, and I'm like, oh, yeah, made her cry. Oh, yeah. And my wife's like, what is wrong with you? My wife's been with me from that far to now in those situations. I just let it go. I don't even care. I mean, if you want to say negative things about me in a line, I mean, it's like.
Well, why? What? I don't understand why she had a problem with you putting that thing down.
You know, there's some people who are going through a thing.
Yeah.
And I this is how I process it now. Some people are going through a thing.
Oh, yeah.
And you setting your stuff down on the conveyor belt isn't the thing. Maybe they're going through a divorce. They're going through a struggle.
No, totally.
And you're just the tipping point. And so they're right. They're near the likes to cry, where it's like a dam that's holding back the tears. Oh, and yeah. As soon as you set your item down, people today, they're just so big. Because it's just.
And I'm sure you've come so far, young man. I promise you this, Clay. It's amazing. It's almost a miracle of human.
It is a miracle.
Of human nature, where you've come from. Because I'm sure if it was only a month after being married, you probably still had that. You know, angry kind of Eminem, you know, look about you, the baggy clothes.
And I brought that to your office every time I visited.
Oh, you're just Shady McShaderson. I mean, it's
every
just
time
like,
I drop Vanessa off, if you got eye contact from the Zolhan, it was like, who is this strange man?
Who is this guy? We're like, because you kept coming around because you guys had the one car and you had to drop her off, pick her up. And so you'd get there early. You'd stay late. You'd kind of snark around, you know.
Subwoofer in the minivan. And I never turned it off for your customers. Every customer got to hear. And so I didn't even know what I didn't know. And that, in my mind, is the value of a business coach, because they can point out to you what you don't know. The things that you don't know will keep you from growing. The things you don't know will still hurt you.
And that leads me to Marshall. You have been business coaching now. You've come through the system. You've got how many clients now are you business coaching?
Almost a doubles baker's dozen.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow. There you go. And what's probably just from the hip. I know we didn't talk about this over the break, but from the hip, what's probably the number one thing that most people, then you're talking about 24 people or thereabouts, 24 people, what's like the number one thing that people don't know, they don't even know? I mean, come top of mind.
I would tell you the one thing that people don't know, what they need to know, is that they need to start hiring now, even if they're fully staffed at their company. They need to start hiring before their staffing becomes an issue. And the reason why is because when you look around at your business and you look around at the inefficiencies, you've grown several businesses. And one of the core foundations of those businesses that you've built are the processes and checklists. And when you don't have good staff operating those processes and checklists, it's very easy to say, hey, we need to go back to the drawing board. Hey, we need to adjust the script. Hey, we need to adjust the checklist. When really it's a human problem.
And you saw this happen. We had a young lady who'd worked here for a while. She's a nice lady. And recently she told my wife and one of our team members, she said, hey, I'm getting married, so I may be moving soon. And if I hadn't always been interviewing and you hadn't been always doing those hiring processes, I probably would have felt bad. I probably would have been like, oh my gosh, how are we going to staff tomorrow? How are we going to fill in? How are we going to deliver? But instead I'm like, okay, let's let her move on.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, you're listening to the Thrive Time Show.
Now, from a marketing perspective, okay, hiring is a thing. Okay, let's go with sales. Where do most clients you've worked with, I mean, you're talking about success stories. You've helped, there's one research lab I know of, you've helped them almost triple in sales. Unbelievable. What is the one thing that everybody listening right now is probably getting wrong in the world of sales?
I got two moves.
Oh, okay? Wow, here we go.
Marketing and sales. Number one, for sales, the first move that most people are not doing is call your leads.
Call your leads?
Call your leads.
Yeah. Call your leads.
That's a huge thing. And so business owners, they are going to spend a ton of money. If you're watching this right now, if you're listening to this, you're spending a ton of money on marketing right now, and you're waiting 3 or 4 days to call back your leads.
Justin, elephant in the room, we have more people that reach out to us right now than what our team can even keep up with. And it's kind of this crazy phenomenon where someone will fill out a form, and our team will call them, and people don't answer the phone number when they don't recognize the phone number. How have you been able to combat this at Elephant in the Room?
So once we put that initial call out and people usually don't answer a call they don't know, we'll follow up with a text just to notify who we are. Maybe they're in a meeting too. So that way they can actually communicate through us via text, via email, or through phone. So we just want to open up the floodgates of communication. And since we do have that call center, it's worked tremendous for us.
I tell you what, Clay, one of the things that I am very impressed about that our team is doing, especially in the in-person workshop and the coaching, and that is all this SEO.
Oh.
You know, I'm old school. You know, I've been, my business is going on 26 years now. I mean, back, you guys, but you young kids may not even realize, but back in the day, we didn't even have the thing called the WWW internet.
You know, when Dr. Z first started his business, this was the theme song he would play every day when he came to work. I think it's very vital. He would play this, and it's just like, here we go. And he'd wear a jean jacket, he'd be rolling in his Volkswagen. Oh man, car flipped up, he had a big old button that had Paula Abdul's name on it. I mean, that's how old school he is. Unbelievable.
It is, but I'll tell you what, when you come to the in-person workshop, not you get some hands-on training on SEO, because you may be saying, hey, I want to be... you know, I'm on page 7 of Google, and that's really good. No. Nobody goes past page 1. It's just the reality of it. And if you do, God bless you. But the thing about it is that learning to get to the top of Google is perhaps 7 figures to some people. I mean, it's millions of dollars worth of stuff. I mean, that's a big move.
I'll give you 2 examples. I know of a lady in the world of real estate who went from no leads to over $24 million of sales as a result of almost exclusively Google. I know of a property management company I met with today whose business has blown up completely as a result of this. I know of a dentist in Tulsa that is scheduled to date. He sent Deidre, one of our coaches, an email. He said he has 7 times more clients this year than last year as a result of Google. And Marshall knows the secrets. So Marshall, we teach these at the workshop. Is this correct? Is this truth?
This is truth. Anybody, anywhere can learn search engine optimization, okay? And I'm going to give them 4 quick moves.
Give it to us.
Number one, you have to have more content about whatever your given keyword is than your competitors. More content.
Give it to us. We need more.
Okay. Number two, you have to have a Google canonical compliant website.
Oh,
okay.
You just said
words.
You got to
follow all the rules that Google sets forward.
Okay.
Number three, you have to be mobile compliant, okay? You have to be mobile compliant. The word on the street is people are using their smartphones. And number four, you got to have more Google reviews than everybody else.
Oh, knowledge bombs left and right. Bombs. If you want a knowledge bomb buffet, you want to learn everything you've ever needed to know to start or grow a successful business, you need to right now. If you know somebody whose business is in the toilet, if you're married to somebody whose business is in the toilet, if you have at least $7 in your pocket, put your hand up. And if you want to start a business, put your hand up. Get out to the in-person Thrivetime workshop. It is the world's best business workshop. If you do not believe me, please read the reviews. Come check it out. We have a money back guarantee. What a money back guarantee. Absolutely. The world's best business workshop. It's practical. It's the stuff behind the stuff. It's the knowledge you do not get in business college. There has never been and there never will be a better business workshop. It's that detailed. It's specific. Z and I are not guys who said, hey, you know what we'll do is let's just come up with a system where we sit when they come to the event, we'll sell them another system. No, this is the stuff. We're teaching you the specific stuff. It's at the Thrive15.com world headquarters in beautiful Jinx, America. Z, where can they learn more information?
You go to ThriveTimeShow.com. That's ThriveTimeShow.com. And while you're here, you might want to sign up for some one-on-one business coaching. You might say, these guys have impacted my life so much, I want a little bit more and I want to personalize. We have that available. You can go on Thrive15.com for $1 the first month and $19 following that. You can be business coached and mentored up. Folks, we're here for you. We're your business source.
I'm telling you what, Thrivers. It's hard to build a reputation based on what you're going to do. So take action today. And as always, three, two, one, boom!